We are predicting every single NFL wildcard game that is upcoming this weekend. The main thing is Myles Garrett needs to be the best player in this game. If he is, the Cleveland Browns will win, and that's what I'm anticipating. In today's episode, we cover everything about the NFL Super Wildcard Weekend, and we also react to the shocking coach firings.
Mike Vrabel fired by the Tennessee Titans.
And stay tuned for our reaction to the horrible officiating in recent NBA games.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the BTR podcast.
Before we get started, please like, comment, and subscribe.
As always, make sure you guys follow our socials linked down below. Make sure you guys also download the podcast on audio platforms if you prefer it that way. Rate it and review it as well. Before we continue, a big podcast episode with a guest dropping this weekend. So make sure you guys check that out, most likely on Saturday night, hoping everything goes well with the upload. And yeah, without further ado, we got a lot to talk about once again. We'll start off with the NFL. The playoffs are here. Let's get our predictions rolling. But we got a lot of coaching firings and news as well, so stay tuned for that. But let's start off with the predictions.
Wildcard weekend. Wildcard weekend is this weekend. And six games to predict here. And we'll give a little mini preview as well of what we expect as well.
What's your game of the week? Is it the Lions-Rams because of the storyline?
Yeah.
Or is it Eagles? Sorry, not Eagles. Chiefs and Dolphins.
I'll go with the Lions-Rams because I feel like I'm more 50-50 on that game, whereas the Chiefs-Dolphins, I feel like I could pick a clear winner.
Actually?
Yeah. Compared
I
to
feel like they're both 50-50 is tough.
Comparing
the two, I still think it's like,
I don't know. The Rams and Lions are tougher to pick.
So you want to start off with that, or do you want to just go in the order of
Let's go in order of game times. Starting off with a tough one as well. Browns, Texans, kickoff here, wildcard weekend, Saturday.
Oh, before we continue, sorry, I dropped YouTube community polls of each wildcard matchup, two a day. So, for example, Wednesday, we released two of them. Texans and Browns are one of them. So go vote on our community tab on our channel. So just vote for who you think is going to win. It's just a simple question, who's going to win that matchup?
Just click a button.
Yeah, and we'll share our prediction.
As well. Our predictions will be right now. Browns, Texans.
So preview first, then we'll go to the prediction.
Yeah, preview. This time it's in Houston. I feel about Houston coming off a game in Indianapolis. And now they're coming into a playoff atmosphere in Houston after winning the division, after the Jags collapse. The Browns, Texans was a lopsided game earlier this year. But that game did not have the main man, CJ Stroud, in it. So it is going to be a completely different game. That is for sure. But the Houston Texans do have injuries, and we don't know if they're going to be fully healthy for game time. Obviously, Will Anderson Jr. is one of them. Jonathan Greenard, Jerry Hughes. And on the offensive side, you have Robert Woods, which is another key weapon after Nico Collins, who has performed amazing this year, especially coming off a 190 receiving yard performance against the Colts. So it's gonna be tight. That is for sure. It's not going to be that week, whatever it was, where the Browns kicked their ass.
Yeah, no. What I want to say about this game is Houston is now home, like you mentioned. And the big question is, can the young guys, the more inexperienced players, you know, play? Are they going to be nervous? Are they going to be ready for this moment? The good news is they have Robert Woods. They got Dalton Schultz, two guys. Laremy Tunsil's been there, right, in the playoffs at least. Before, so they have guys that will share with them, and they have the main guy, D'Amico Ryans, right, with San Francisco. So he knows what a winning culture and all that is. He established that well with Houston, as we mentioned. And so what I'm looking for is, can CJ Stroud continue doing this? And he has not given me a reason not to. Like we mentioned, Indy, he goes into that hostile environment and took control of the game. Was the obviously the guy who had the last drive pretty much win the game for him. And then on top of that, you got what would you call it? What am I blanking?
Nico?
No, not Nico, even. I was still sticking with CJ. He had that Georgia performance when he played for Ohio State. And that if it wasn't for Marvin Harrison Jr., they probably could have won it all, for all we know, right? And so he's had the moments. He has the confidence. He has the swagger to lead a team. I wouldn't even consider this an upset if Houston loses this game, right? I know the experience may favor Cleveland a little bit more. because Joe Flacco is also there and he's balling.
Cleveland is the favorite.
You know, they are the favorite, but I'm just saying, like, I wouldn't consider it, like, you know how we do upset alerts?
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't consider this an upset alert. But I think Houston on a roll. CJ, whenever he's played, is on a roll. I don't think he's really had any bad moments except for maybe one game this past year. And, yeah, and on top of that, I think D'Amico will have him well prepared. They're all playing. They're also going in that underdog. They are going into that underdog mentality, us against the world, which fair, because no one thought they were going to be at this spot, let alone, you know, we said it, let alone a playoff spot. They won the division, right? Yeah. So that being said, that's what I'm looking from on the Houston side of things. Cleveland is, okay, let's see what their defense is. Is Joe Flacco?
Let's see what
is Joe Flacco and Amari Cooper.
Their defense, is elite.
Yeah,
we don't need to see that. We know that.
The question is Joe Flacco and Amari Cooper going to be one of the best duos like they have been, and with David Njoku as the other option as well? Because on one side you have the quarterback play in CJ Stroud, which will help you win a Super Bowl. Cleveland's defense can help you win a Super Bowl with regular. Even if Joe Flacco isn't like how he was in the regular season, because we saw Jimmy Garoppolo go all the way to the Super Bowl. We've seen Jared Goff go all the way to the Super Bowl. Yeah, did they win? No, they didn't. But we saw Nick Foles win it as well with good coaching and all that stuff.
Being on the Cleveland side here, the defense is what kept them together all year. There's no question about that. They had, like, coming into the season, they were a sneaky contender. You could agree with that. On paper, their team was pretty good.
Yeah.
But Nick Chubb goes down. Deshaun Watson isn't performing like how he once was.
And then goes down,
right? So there was question. Obviously, they won games with P.J. Walker. Dorian Thompson-Robinson was not the answer as well.
P.J. Walker was still a question mark wins, too.
They were close. They were tight, right? I think the one against Colts and the Niners were questionable refereeing as well. Joe Flacco comes in, and this offense just starts clicking, right? We've seen Amari Cooper get involved, right? Amari Cooper had a franchise record-setting day against the Houston Texans. So, yes, CJ Stroud did not play that game, but Amari Cooper is not facing CJ Stroud. Amari Cooper is facing that secondary, right? So, offensively, I'm confident in Cleveland Browns putting up the same performance again against that defense. The issue is this defense will be way more tested because there's no Case Keeman and Davis Mills duo coming in. It's CJ Stroud. So, the biggest key to this game is getting to the quarterback, because quarterbacks like CJ Stroud, who are kind of like Joe Burrow, right? Who kind of like, they are pocket passers. Like, they will pick you apart. They are accurate, right? And if you give him time, which he had in a lot in the Indianapolis game, he picked us apart. And doesn't matter what defense you have, how good you are, he can pick you apart, especially with the way that Nico Collins is playing and him getting opened up. The main thing is Myles Garrett needs to be the best player in this game. If he is, the Cleveland Browns will win, and that's what I'm anticipating.
CJ Stroud, like you said, he'll put the ball in the right spot. Like, when he was pressured,
he still did it,
and you had Nico Collins make a play for him as well, but he put it at the spot, right? So that being said, let's go with the prediction, because we've got another game, five other games to talk about. I ultimately, like I said, I voted on the community poll as well with my personal account. I went with the Houston Texans winning. Home field is a factor. I just feel like that mentality they have, D'Amico has set them up with. Yes, the injuries, I need to see how healthy they're going to be. But at the same time, I have more trust in CJ Stroud. Right, I have more faith in CJ Stroud against that defense, personally. And then I feel like the defense can hold their own on Joe Flacco. Again, assuming D'Amico will fix things, and I have faith in that. Right, I'm not saying D'Amico's a better coach than Stefanski or whatever the whole group is, but Bobby Slowick is a good offensive mind. He'll get the plays going right away. Get CJ, get Dalton, and all these guys, Nico Collins, and Damian Pierce, whoever else is running the ball for them. And yeah, I think D'Amico on the defensive side, like I said, we've seen him do it with San Francisco, so I don't have no other questions about it. I think it's a close game. I think it's like a 3-point game.
Yeah,
but.
It is hard to beat a team twice. I will say that much. Here's the thing. I like Cleveland's defense better than Houston's defense. All right.
I agree with
as
that
much,
too.
And it's by like a tier and a half they're above.
Okay.
Coaching is similar. They both are head coaching candidates. They're both not head coaching. They're coach of the year candidates. Right. Quarterback.
Probably the top two.
Yeah. Quarterback wise, I have to respect what Flacco has done.
Yeah, no, for sure.
But I agree with you. I give the edge to CJ Stroud. But in this case, everything's level for me. Experience takes it over. Flacco is a Super Bowl MVP. Flacco has a 10-5 playoff record, right? The Cleveland Browns in the 2020 season, most of their players upset the Pittsburgh Steelers and lost to the Chiefs by 5 in the divisional round. So for that reason, I am going with the Cleveland Browns to win this game. I believe Flacco is going to perform well. I think Amari Cooper is going to have another good game. And it's going to be a thing where, like, I think CJ Stroud and the Texans will have the ball at the end to tie the game. And that is where Myles Garrett or Za'Darius Smith come up with the clutch sack that you always need to win the game, in a playoff game especially.
Yeah.
And that's what's going to happen. And I think Cleveland Browns take this by a touchdown score.
Yeah, no, I'm kind of rooting for a bigger underdog story here. By the way, we will be dropping a special video regarding underdogs in the playoffs, so make sure you guys check that out, coming out this week as well. But yeah, ultimately, I think you weighed the Cleveland defense more than the quarterback.
I weighed the experience more.
Yeah, plus the defense as well.
The defense and the quarterback for me is like evened it out. Like, I gave the edge to CJ, but I'm giving the edge to Cleveland's defense.
Yeah, no, I'm weighing the CJ factor a little bit more.
That's fair. It's QB.
I mean, I think he's top three MVP candidate this year. All
fair.
Said and done.
That's fair.
You could argue offensive rookie of the year because there's obviously different argument with that one, but
yeah, Puka's in the conversation. But yeah, let's move on to the next game. A big one. Saturday night, 5 p.m. Dolphins, Chiefs. Tyreek Hill's return to Arrowhead. And Dolphins, Chiefs, they both had their good moments and bad moments. Obviously, Dolphins had way more good moments than the Chiefs, but the Chiefs were more of like a level team, where like they were more consistent, in my opinion. The Dolphins beat up on the bad teams. The Chiefs just could not get their offense going. But the difference this year is the defense has bailed them out, other than years prior where the offense bailing out the defense. So it's a close one. Don't get me wrong. But with the Dolphins' record against good teams, it's, for me, is kind of leaning one way. But yeah, let's talk about the game quickly first. It's going to come down to, can Travis Kelce and Mahomes find their connection? I don't give a shit what other receivers are doing, right? They're dropping balls. They're doing this, doing that. The Mahomes and Kelce connection has not been the same this year.
Yeah, no, for sure.
All right, and if that's not the same, I'm sorry, like, Kadarius Toney, Valdez-Scantling, you don't have much of a chance. Right, like, it has to go through Kelce and Mahomes, and that connection has not been the same. But the good news for Chiefs fans is they're clutch. They always come up in big moments. And what's a bigger moment than an Arrowhead game ruining Tyreek Hill's return in a playoff atmosphere?
For me, okay, so I do partially agree with that. The reason why I slightly disagree is, I get what you're saying, you need to figure out that thing. My point, counterpoint to that is, if you're going to take away your best weapon, which is Travis Kelce, Marcus Valdez-Scantling, Rasheed Rice, right? That's
how it is? He's been good. Rasheed Rice has been pretty good.
And then, yeah, Rasheed Rice. I'm mixing the guy up from New Orleans, that's why.
That's Rasheed Shaheed.
Yeah, so it's like similar names. Yeah. Rice and then Kadarius Toney, they need to step up, right? I have faith in Isaiah Pacheco or whoever else is running.
Oh, running game is fine.
Running game is fine. The reason why I'm saying that, Vic Fangio's a smart defensive guy. He's going to find a way to stop Travis Kelce. The way, it's like the run game. If you have a run game going, you'll open up more of the field. It's like if you have shooters in basketball, you're going to find more lanes to the basket. If one of those wide receivers can get going and spread the ball around and they make plays consistently from the get-go, Travis Kelce will get more open.
True, that's true.
Right? Travis Kelce then will, on a one-on-one situation, will probably, then I agree with you, he better make those plays on a one-on-one situation. I know he's had a few drops, I get that, but for the most part, it's because everything's on his shoulders from whatever Mahomes is throwing.
Yeah,
right?
My counterpoint.
So that's why I agree with that.
I get you.
Have to figure out a way to get the others rolling, and the other guys need to make play to help Travis Kelce open the ball a little bit more.
This is another game where it's a rematch from a regular season game.
Yeah.
In that game, we saw the Miami Dolphins shut down Travis Kelce. The difference this game is Bradley Chubb is not there. Jalen Phillips is not there. Xavien Howard might not be there.
Yeah.
Right? Two of your top pass rushers are not going to be in this game, meaning Mahomes, with that good O-line, or decently...
The O-line kind of underperformed this year.
Yeah, but like, on paper.
But to your point, they paper, should be better now with those injuries.
With those injuries, you're giving Mahomes time.
Yeah.
Right? And obviously, because of that, Travis Kelce and Mahomes' connection works best when Mahomes is scrambling around the pocket, buying time. And Kelce is like, he's not running his route. He's just like, okay, I don't give a shit about my route. I just need to get away to get open to help my quarterback. That is when
kinda
they're,
like
at,
that play that
that
got
is when they're at their best.
Kind of like that play that got called back. Remember that?
Yeah,
like,
and against the Buffalo Bills.
Kadarius Toney was offside.
Yeah.
And then got the touchdown, but called back.
Yep, so that's the Chiefs offense versus the Dolphins defense, who Dolphins defense is pretty beat up. So Vic Fangio has to put up a masterclass. But let's flip on the other side of the ball. The Dolphins offense versus the Chiefs defense.
What's Jalen Waddle's status?
Again, it was questionable. like all these players, they're all questionable.
At the end of the day, Spags obviously knows Tyreek Hill. Spagnuolo will find a way to limit Tyreek Hill. I'm not saying he'll shut him out.
I don't think we're gonna know any injuries until like game time, bro. Like,
unless something's already there. Yeah, he's questionable.
Yeah, they're all like.
But then again, we saw because he's a speedster as well. His ankle's gonna take an account of his speed.
Oh yeah, 100%.
Right, we saw Will Anderson not play the whole game against the Colts because of his ankle injury. In this case, yeah, let's see what happens because. The meme is Tua is just going to find a slant to Tyreek Hill all day, every day, or just Tyreek Hill beat a route and he'll just get there. Like you said, the Chiefs defense is now the bailing out of the offense. Usually it's the other way around. And in this case, Steve Spagnuolo knows what to do. They have a good secondary. That performed well. They obviously have a good pass rushing.
They have good overall defense.
Chris Jones, George Karloftis, and all these guys there. Willie Gay Jr. is their linebacker. So, defensively, I have more faith in them stopping that offense because I think, and we don't even know what Mostert's health is going to be.
Questionable.
Achain is doing good. Don't get me wrong. So, but like you said, are those guys going to fold in the big moment? And guess what? They're also away, right? They're playing at Arrowhead.
The thing is this, they've been folding in good big moments all year long.
Yeah.
And apart from the Cowboys game, but realistically, an away Cowboys game is kind of like beating up on a bad team.
The good news is you have Tyreek Hill and you kind of have an inside mole, but obviously the Chiefs know that they're going to switch things up, obviously, but...
Yeah, so the thing was this, right? Like, Tua is obviously best when he is, I know, standing still in the pocket, like, not really scrambling, whereas, like, Mahomes is, I believe, better... Obviously, I'm not saying Mahomes is bad when he's like in the pocket,
no,
like, but like I think Mahomes is better when he's scrambling and making plays like that. Tua, I don't think is good at that. Tua needs to like get rid of the ball quick. He needs this run game to be going.
Yeah.
Chiefs defense is no joke, right? Especially with Chris Jones, you know, leading that line. If this run game doesn't get going, they can't open up the field for Tyreek. If they can't open up the field for Tyreek, they can't get anything going because at the end of the day, you have to get the ball to Tyreek in many ways. And it has shown proven over and over again. The Dolphins have came. They're not even close. They've been getting like destroyed in these big games. And Mike McDaniel has been getting out-coached in these big games. So it's going to come down to both their offensive performance and Mike McDaniel's play calling.
So going to the prediction, you pretty much nailed it on the head. They're frauds to me. They haven't shown me one quality win. And by quality, like we said, a big team win.
Oh, well, given the Cowboys, they have one.
Yeah, okay, fine. But, like, it wasn't, like, a dominant performance either. They're away. They're going to Arrowhead. It's going to be one of the coldest games of the year. Miami.
It's hot.
It's hot, literally. So, it's supposed to be, like, 0 degrees Fahrenheit or, like, even the -2 Fahrenheit, which is supposed to be record-breaking, NFL record-breaking coldest game of the year. And for that, it's one factor. We all know the Chiefs' home field advantage there in the stadium. The loudness and everything like that, and throw in Patrick Mahomes who performs well in the playoffs pretty much always. Travis Kelce, same thing, and then that defense is not the same defense from a couple of years ago. That this defense is the reason why they're in the playoffs mainly right now and a division winner. Give me the Chiefs. Give me them by a touchdown or two. I don't know.
Yeah,
the Dolphins choked their chance away.
I'm not confident
in the Dolphins.
Give me the Chiefs.
If the Dolphins, however, win this game some way somehow, then I could see this team making a run.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But
they got to win. Yeah, give me the Chiefs. They got to win a play. They got to win a big game, which they haven't done all year. And the Chiefs have beaten some big.
Don't get me
teams.
Wrong. The Chiefs haven't won spectacularly all year either.
Yeah, they're not the same Chiefs.
But I have the home field is also a big factor. I have more faith in the Chiefs than I do with the Dolphins.
All right, moving on. Bills, Steelers. This is probably going to be one of the easier picks weekend.
Let's just quickly talk about it.
TJ Watt's quickly. That's a big factor.
Mason Rudolph's your starter.
And no knock on Mason Rudolph. He has been your best quarterback this year. At the end of the day, we got to give him credit, like how we gave it to Flacco, right? Like this guy came in, you know, saved the Steelers season, performed well, and is one of the reasons why they've been killing it this last couple of weeks. So at the end of the day, we got to give him his credit. He could still perform well. The Bills are known to play to their opponent's level, obviously, when it's the big games like the Eagles, the Chiefs, the Dolphins, they play good. But when it's like the Jets, they lose.
This year, yeah, but we also seen them what they did to the New England Patriots a couple of years ago and shutting them out. Remember, like that was the same question mark then. But
yeah, no, so the difference here.
The difference here is the Bills are also on a five or six game win streak.
Five game win streak coming into the playoffs. They're one of the hottest teams. It's as simple as this: the Steelers' only chance is like as they turn over Josh Allen more than like twice. Like I still think the Bills could win this game if Josh Allen throws two interceptions.
Minka's healthy, right?
I don't know, man. At this rate, like, is heavily favored for the Bills that.
Yeah, it should be.
Yeah.
Like, the Steelers barely made the playoffs.
I think Minka is healthy.
Okay, but either way, you're arguably defensive player of the year again. TJ Watt's injured. Right? How else are you going to win? JJ Watt's questioning. JJ Watt's saying, I'm going to do some WWE shit. I'll sub in for him and play on the McAfee show today. But.
No, as simple as this. For the Bills, defense, obviously, just find a way to get to Mason Rudolph, make him rush. And then offensively, just don't turn over the ball and lean on your run game and find a way to get Diggs involved again. And it's a simple game plan for the Bills, right? And I'm picking the Bills.
Yeah, I'm picking the Bills. It's an easy pick. I don't know, multiple scores. Josh Allen will probably still throw a pick, but
he's on a streak. Definitely on a streak.
The streak is still continuing, but at the same time, we could see him bounce back. They're coming off a high with a big win, and they're home, so there's that factor as well. So yeah, this we're not gonna spend too much time on it. Bills, move on to the next round.
Another, in my opinion, should be an easy prediction, but at the end of the day, they are the Cowboys. Cowboys Packers, the 2 seed versus the 7 seed in the NFC. Mike McCarthy's revenge game against the Green Bay Packers is upcoming. This game's the second game on Sunday. Cowboys. In my personal opinion, this is the best Cowboys we've seen in the recent years. Dak has looked very good. Obviously, CeeDee Lamb is a career year for him. And defensively, we've already been saying the last couple of years, led by Micah Parsons and Dan Quinn, they have been killer.
If the Cowboys, this is what I want to say about the Cowboys. If the Cowboys do not do it this year, this is the best chance, and I agree with you. They're probably losing Dan Quinn. When we get to the coaching hirings in a second, or firings or let goes of the second, because Seattle's coach is vacant. Seattle has a coaching vacancy. Dan Quinn was the coach, defensive coordinator during their Super Bowl win, the Super Bowl finals loss with that Legion of Boom. To me, it'll be no surprise if he goes back home, and I anticipate that. We'll talk about predictions about that in a second. So you're going to have, you potentially will lose him. So that's one key factor there. And currently, the only team you need to worry about in that conference is the San Francisco 49ers.
Yes.
So, nothing short of an NFC championship game is a massive disappointment. Don't get me wrong. No discredit to... I'm going to give credit to Green Bay, the Packers, because they've been killing it. For the last couple of weeks, Jordan Love looks good. But again, this Dallas team is on a different level, and I understand what happens in the playoffs. Don't get me wrong. Because who's their second-round matchup if they win this? Most likely, in your opinion, like
the 3 seed, so it could be the Lions or the
Rams.
Not the Rams. The Rams will probably go.
Oh, if the Rams win, they'll be
going. The Rams will go to 49ers. It could be the Eagles. It could be the Bucks. It could be the Lions.
You're by far the better team outside of the Niners, and if there's no excuse for you not to at least, you know, Super Bowl or bust for sure. Because next year, I will not be surprised. The Eagles are going to be better, in my opinion. Next year, I feel like the Eagles will figure shit out. This year, as of right now, we haven't seen the first games. The Eagles are horrendous. They're worse than what we said about the Dolphins right now.
Yeah.
Right? So there's zero excuses. Give me Dallas with a win. I'm going to just say that right now. And I'm sure you're saying the same thing.
Yes.
But can Green Bay figure out a way to win? Yeah, simple.
Green Bay do have a chance.
I'm not saying they
don't. Here is Green Bay's chance. First of all, whoever is questionable, pray that they're healthy. Playing. Yeah. Christian Watson, Romy Doubs, Jair Alexander, Elton Jenkins, their old lineman. So that's number one. Number two, if they are healthy, it's gonna be a good matchup. Keeping Love upright is gonna be key, and especially with Gilmore also being questionable as well, they can do something in this passing game. Obviously, they got Aaron Jones back, so let's see if they could do run game. But I think this is gonna, their run defense hasn't been, it's probably their weakness. Like, they don't have the weakness, but if I were to pick something, like really nitpick the Cowboys defense is a run. And they're going to need Elton Jenkins and Aaron Jones, right, to play well in order to open up this passing game.
Defensively, right? They just need to figure out to get to the QB. But Dak under duress, Dak will make a mistake.
That is true.
That's the one way they will win. If Dak has time, Dak will pick you apart with the way CeeDee Lamb's been playing this year.
So use your run game to help you pass.
Yeah.
Right? And I know I've been saying this for a lot of, like, couple other teams as well. But this one especially, just because we know how elite the Cowboys defense is. And like you, I'm going with the Cowboys and with a big win here. And if they don't win, it'll probably be the most disappointing loss in the last, them, in recent
yeah.
memory.
Yeah.
Like, I would consider this
more disappointing. Okay, if they were to lose, predict how they would lose. We saw last year what happened with that play call.
Nothing. I feel like it might be just Mike McCarthy, bad time management type thing.
Okay.
But yeah, next game. The big game. Sunday nighter. Rams-Lions. Rams on a heater. Next to the Bills are one of the hottest teams coming into the playoffs. Detroit Lions are coming off a high, especially when they finally clinched the division after 30 years and are in the playoff spot. The big storyline coming into this game is Stafford and Goff are facing their former teams. And Stafford's homecoming, because this game's at Ford Field in Detroit. The thing here is, how are the Lions defense going to hold up against Puka Nacua, Tyler Higbee, Cooper Kupp, and obviously Matthew Stafford running the show with Kyron Williams as well? That is my biggest question.
If I'm the Detroit Lions, congratulations, you made it. Worst possible matchup you could get in the first round.
Yes.
For me. You got Matthew Stafford coming home for the first time. And obviously, he's helped you make the playoffs twice, but at the same time, you haven't helped him much. He might want to look for a vengeance, because literally, this is his third year? So 3 years and 2 years into it, you took a good direction, just missed the playoffs last year, and in the third year, you won the division, right? Now, granted, you did that because Aaron Rodgers is out of the division as well. All that helps. And then
I mean, they beat Aaron Rodgers last year anyways.
Last year in general, but I'm saying that helps. And I've talked about that 1 year. When the Rams won it, but it's a tough one, and I have my pick. I'll wait to say it. I think the way the Rams win is just their experience alone will just help that. The defense has been up and down for Detroit over the year, right, over the season. Like, they started off decent, then they kind of went downhill for a bit. Remember that little stretch where, like, here comes the normal Detroit Lions? And then even when they came back against Chicago, it was after that game. I think they lost one, and then they went off after Thanksgiving as well. That's when I'm like, okay, they might come along, and they could win this game. And again, by no means, by whichever team loses, is an upset. I think it's an even 50-50 pick, as similar to the Browns and the...
It's a -3, so it's pretty close.
Yeah, so it's similar to Browns and Texans, in my opinion. Detroit wins this game simply just being the more physical team, the Dan Campbell style.
Okay, yeah. So here's the thing. Rams offense needs to be stellar in order for them to have a chance. The Lions offense needs to be stellar as well. The Rams are 12th against in run defense, but they're 20th against the pass, and obviously... We all know the Rams' big playmakers on defense are on the D-line with Kobe Turner, Byron Young, who stepped up, and then obviously Aaron Donald. So this is where Amon-Ra St. Brown needs to be the Lions' best player in order for the Lions to, you know, win. But on the flip side, I am concerned for the Lions' defense, but we know their best. They have C.J. Gardner-Johnson back, obviously, which is big. The other guy they need is Aiden Hutchinson, because Stafford, like Stroud, like Jordan Love, if he's upright, he'll pick you apart. So Rams, the Achilles heel of this Rams offense, which I was really concerned about, was his offensive line and how they're going to protect Stafford. If Aiden Hutchinson is in Stafford's face, they have no chance. And for that reason, I think Aiden Hutchinson is going to play well. I think Amon-Ra St. Brown is going to play well. I think Jared Goff is going to have a turnover-free game. And I'm going with the Detroit Lions. I had Rams earlier on. I did switch it. But I'm going with the Detroit Lions.
Aiden Hutchinson might go on that Michigan high as well. With Michigan winning it all, his alma mater, right? Okay, so my prediction, I kind of alluded to it a little bit. I'm going with the Rams. I think this is the worst matchup Detroit could have in the first round out of almost any team because of Matthew Stafford coming home. For me, defensively, I trust Raheem Morris a little bit more than Aaron Glenn. I'm not saying that Aaron Glenn hasn't done a terrible job. Your point, he'll figure out ways to get to Stafford, especially how that O-line, which did better than many people expected, right, including yourself, to keep Matthew Stafford healthy. Matthew Stafford's been there and done that. Jared Goff, even the Super Bowl run, wasn't, like, great, right? Jared Goff, this year, from one point we said, oh, this guy hasn't thrown picks, has thrown many picks, and is prone to mistakes. Jared Goff isn't like that extreme confident quarterback in a big-time moment. Nothing's more big-time than Detroit's first playoff game in a while, first division win, first home playoff game in a while, right? First division win in 30 years. Give me the Rams, strictly because the experience there. Sean McVay's play calling, well, as good as Ben Johnson is, I'm taking Sean McVay. Cooper Kupp will come back and be that safety blanket, but having Puka Nacua emerge like he did, and that run game with Kyren Williams emerge like he did, it's going to hurt the Lions, in my opinion, way more. I trust that offense more than their offense, and I trust their their offense to be better than the Detroit defense and vice versa. And then how vice versa.
Honestly, the way on paper this how this game's match up, it should be more of an offensive shootout than it is a defensive showdown.
Yeah. But you got that guy in Aaron Donald.
So it might just come down to like who has the ball last if both offenses are cooking.
And then defensively for me, you have Aaron Donald, and we know how he could close a game down. We saw it in the Super Bowl.
We saw him close the game down, but the same thing could be said for Aiden Hutchinson as well.
No, Aaron Donald.
Huh? I'm not saying they're the same level, but I'm saying they both have the ability.
I know, but I'm saying
they both have the ability to finish the game.
I agree with that.
That's what I said.
But Aaron Donald.
Yeah, it's Aaron Donald. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying they're the same level. But yeah, last game, Eagles Buccaneers.
Oh, so just to make it clear, he picked the Lions and I picked the Rams.
Eagles Buccaneers. Obviously, the Bucs were coming off a division win. It doesn't really count for anything because it is NFC South. Eagles are coming off a massive collapsing last 5-6 weeks, ever since the loss to the 49ers, where they lost to the Cardinals and the Giants. The Buccaneers will start off here with first. They've been on a nice little run here up until week 17, where they got destroyed by the Saints, and then barely beating the Panthers to get in. Baker Mayfield has looked good overall this year. Obviously, incredible year for Mike Evans again. You have Chris Godwin. The thing here is, are they gonna do it in the big game, right? And that is the biggest question for Baker is, can he carry the load? And that has been his biggest question all his whole career. He did that 1 year with the Cleveland, where they made the playoffs and obviously upset the Steelers. And on the flip side, the Eagles defense, have not looked good at all. So it is a prime opportunity for Baker to cook.
Eagles made this difficult for sure. Like the way they've been playing, right? I mean, they should not have been in this position in the first place. I agree with you on the Tampa side of things because the Eagles don't even know who their defensive play caller is. And either way, Sean Desai struggled. And if Matt Patricia is not in the New England system, he isn't that great either at the moment. To your point, Baker, who's going to really stop Mike Evans? Darius Slay has been up and down with injuries as well. I think he should be back for this game, if I'm not mistaken.
Bradbury ain't.
Bradbury, yeah, if good luck, because Bradbury's going to get cooked in coverage, right? And Mike Evans is motivated. He's on a contract year. You know, potentially future Colt like you're wearing, hopefully,
yeah.
But I doubt it. On the flip side, let's talk about the Bucs defense before we go to the Eagles, because Antoine Winfield got snubbed.
He's pissed,
right? Like, he's snubbed from the Pro Bowl list. I don't know if he made All Pro or whatever or those rankings are. I forget at the top of my head, but not important right now. And like I mentioned, the Eagles offense has been predictable. Brian Johnson, I believe is his name, who's calling it, or whoever is calling it. Outside of the tush push, because they can't stop it, really. And AJ Brown, we don't know what his status is.
As well. Devontae Smith as well. The thing is this. The Eagles need to rely on Jalen Hurts here.
And Jalen Hurts has been making mistakes. And guess what? And you have Antoine Winfield.
You know why the reason is? Buccaneers' run defense has been stellar in these last few years, and they've always been good. So, obviously, Vita Vea is the big reason there. So, the Eagles are really going to have to lean on that play action and the passing game. So, they're going to need AJ Brown. They're going to need Devontae Smith healthy for that. Obviously, O-line-wise, I believe they'll be able to protect Hurts. Hurts could scramble around by time as well. We know he could do that. The issue is, are they going to be predictable or not? And they have been a lot of this year. Another thing is, the Eagles did beat the Buccaneers in Tampa in week 3.
That was way earlier in the season, though.
Yeah, but it was kind of the similar Eagles, right? It's like, I don't think...
True, and I get
that. We had question marks for that team, and that beat the Buccaneers. And then again, I think it's still the same Bucks team. Yes, the Eagles are on a low, like an all-time low right now. But this is the best matchup you could have gotten for your wildcard game. And this could be the best matchup to get yourself back on the high and set yourself up for a potential Super Bowl run. But this right now is going to be a tough game. You made it a tough decision.
Yeah.
But I am going with the Philadelphia Eagles.
I'm going with the Eagles as well. It's tough. I really don't want to. I will not be surprised if the Bucks win this game. Grant, like, literally, we just saw Arizona beat the Eagles.
We saw the Giants do it.
So, yeah, I know. I'll go with the Eagles. I guess the caveat is AJ Brown. If AJ Brown's not healthy, then I'm going with the Bucks. I have to, unfortunately. But I'm assuming this prediction is based on how AJ Brown is playing, even though he might be hobbled. So with that being said, yeah, I'll go with the Eagles. This might be the game that could turn it around and maybe go on a run. But I said that when they finally won a game before and during this stretch of losing, and they did not, essentially, right? So yeah, I'll give Eagles the benefit of the doubt just because I don't trust Tampa that much either.
A lot of rematches, right? Like a lot of teams playing each other again.
Yeah, I just don't trust Tampa that much.
In this postseason, you got Chiefs, Dolphins playing each other again for the second time this year. Browns, Texans are playing each other again. And then the Eagles, Bucks are playing each other again.
And then you got storylines in general.
And then you got storylines galore everywhere else.
Yeah. So those are our predictions. Comment yours down below. Like I said, go check out the YouTube community post. They all should be out by Friday. Total. Everything. So we already have two. By the time this comes out, 3-4 of them should be out already. 3-4 of them should be out. So go vote down there. We want to see what you guys think. And yeah,
we're gonna move on to
The coaching, let's talk. I want to quickly bring the free agency thing up just to show a list of names, because some fans are on off-season mode, and some, you know, shout out to this one guy who put out a list. So Mike Clay on Twitter at Mike Clay NFL put a sneak peek at the 2024 free agency cheat sheet. So these are the people that are on free agents. So people that are looking at the QB market, I'm not going to name all of them. You guys could Google it yourselves. But the names on the QB market, Kirk Cousins, we don't know what his status is going to be. Baker Mayfield, Gardner Minshew, Joe Flacco. Now you got to mention his name.
I think he's signed, is he not?
No, just for the year.
Oh, okay. I thought
he's a free agent. Like, he just signed for the year.
Okay, I thought he was able.
No, he just made his contract guaranteed and pro contract or whatever. Yeah, yeah. And then obviously Ryan Tannehill. Those are the names I'm looking out for. But the teams that want to make a run in the playoffs, not a good way. You have to either look at the trade market or find to draft one.
Yeah, 100% there.
Tight end, the best one here is, not the best one. I'll say a couple. Dalton Schultz, Hunter Henry, Noah Fant, Gerald Everett, and Mike Gesicki.
All decent tight ends.
There are a lot of decent, like Austin Hooper, Irv Smith Jr.
Austin Hooper's. Yeah, they're beyond their time. A lot of these guys are old.
Beyond their time, yeah.
Right, these are big names like 2 years ago.
So this decision could make the Chargers easier, depending on if they take Brock Bowers or not. Gerald Everett will find a new team who's pretty decent.
Wide receiver wise, we have There's a couple good ones.
But no, I expect some of them to stay. But T. Higgins, Michael Pittman Jr., Mike Evans, Calvin Ridley, Marquise Brown, Gabe Davis, Michael Thomas. I don't know why it says Michael A. Thomas. OBJ. I didn't know he signed 1 year.
He signed 1 year, yeah.
So those are the big Tyler Boyd. I guess I got to throw him
out there. Tyler Boyd's a decent.
Darnell Mooney.
It's okay. But yeah, that's it really for wide receivers. Nothing else good as well.
And then running back wise, Saquon, Josh Jacobs, Austin Eckler, Derrick Henry, Tony Pollard, DeAndre Swift.
Hey, man, it's running backs. No one's going to really sign these guys anyways.
But there's a lot of good names out here.
But there are good names.
Zach Moss.
Oh, yeah. You definitely.
And then kicker wise, the best kicker is Nick Folk.
Wow. Which is old boy Nick Folk.
Greg Zuerlein, Chase McLaughlin. So, yeah. So, those are some of the sneak peeks. So, those of you that are looking to see, you guys could, you know, look at some NFL mock drafts in the meantime if your team is eliminated at this point. So, but let's get to the actual news, the big news of the day that kind of carried. Let's start off with the older one that happened a couple of days ago. We had two surprise moves.
Yes.
Number one, the older news, Mike Vrabel fired by the Tennessee Titans. The fired part is surprising me.
Yeah, okay, the thing here with this, right, like we've seen a couple reports where like the Titans can part ways with Mike Vrabel, and that's why I'm not like completely like shocked, but I am surprised because I still think Mike Vrabel did a good job with the Titans from taking him to really bad to a decent playoff contender. Obviously, not much playoff success, but Mike Vrabel is a good coach. He should be one of the top candidates available for any other openings, which they are like another set, six more, just because Titans are not included Titans. So, yeah, I know. I was a little bit surprised. That's for sure.
Yeah. I would have given him at least two more years, one depending on how next.
Probably one. One.
One for sure. But here's the thing. He does not have a great roster around to play with either.
Not really. Their quarterback was...
He got Tannehill playing... Well, not him, but like I guess Arthur Smith for a little
bit. Tannehill played well, but he didn't have like a top-tier quarterback.
Yeah, like Arthur Smith got the best he can before he went to Atlanta. And even after that, after Arthur Smith left for Atlanta, he whoever was their OC afterwards didn't do a bad job. Yes, it helped that you created... The thing is, he created a culture.
That's
it was
a big
run
point.
Game and physical defense, right?
They were physical. They're
then
a physical
you
team.
Had, but then the minute they traded away AJ Brown, I don't know how much it was his decision or not. And then you got rid of John Newsmith as well. So your physical guys are all gone. Derrick Henry then left exposed by himself. Like that's like the main thing you had. Of course, you're going to have bad years. You choked late last year to Jacksonville. Right, giving away the division and ultimately missing the playoff spot. And then this year, you just were never good. You brought in DeAndre Hopkins, prop to you, but I don't know why it did not work out. And yeah, I mean, you fired...
I mean, it didn't work out,
but at the same
right?
time,
like,
you...
Hopkins is not the same player.
You don't fire a guy who set a culture like that. And we're going to talk about other coaches and the NBA.
But how much is
there's a coach thing we got to
How much
about.
Is like they want to change the scenery and like get a...
I think here's the thing.
Get an offensive guy for someone
here's
like...
the difference.
Get an offensive guy for someone like Will Levis to develop it.
Well, they're interviewing like defensive guys right now. I think from what I know. But no, here's the difference. I agree with that. They should get an offensive guy. But their GM was fired a couple of years ago, right?
Yeah, I believe. Think, yeah.
This is not his coach.
That is true.
So
too.
That's probably
another
a factor
yeah.
in this as well. But Mike Vrabel should be the favorite on any spot because
he has
the experience. He's been in the playoffs. Maybe his style might not win in the playoffs.
Potential Patriots.
Yeah, like we'll get to in a second. Maybe his style might not win it all in the playoffs. I don't know, right? It depends on his staff. But, yeah, I think it's stupid. You can't fire a guy like Mike Vrabel right now.
I don't think it's like... Okay, I am surprised. I think just the team's been shifting, right? Like, the thing with Mike Vrabel is, like, he got him from bad to good, but they're now going back down to bad.
I get it.
So that little timeline, I don't think it's, like, it's falling apart. I do agree he should have had one more year and like to fully assess, but at the same time, I don't see it being a super massive issue like that they want to have a change of scenery or like a change of leadership.
I don't think this was the year to do it, personally. I don't think so. Because I would maybe change your staff a little bit on the offensive side and try to work well with Will Levis. I don't know who their current OC is. I'm not going to bother checking it. Clearly, it doesn't matter. They didn't go anywhere with it later on, but... For me, it's like maybe see who's out there. Maybe bring back Arthur Smith. I don't think he's going to get another head coaching job. Arthur Smith, at the end of the day, was a good OC.
He was very good. He deserved his head coaching opportunity.
Yeah, opportunity, for sure, yeah. right? But I don't think he's going to get another one now.
Yeah, he's going to have to earn his way back.
Maybe bring him back, see what he could have done. I don't know. Again, the point is the GM was new, so that wasn't his head coach. Mike Vrabel should be the top on every head coaching vacancy. So, but in my opinion, if I were to make a prediction, as long as Bill leaves, which I think he reports are he probably might, especially with how other stuff is trending, I have some bold predictions to make. He's the first guy to become the coach of the New England Patriots.
100% agree.
He's in their Ring of Honor. He's in their Hall of Fame. Whatever. He's a 3-time Super Bowl champ, as their linebacker, I believe. So, yeah, there's a if anywhere, it's gonna be New England. I think that's where he's gonna end up. If Bill stays, he might join his staff for 1 year if he knows the inside story of Bill's leaving.
Yeah, yeah.
And he joins the New England staff, then I know he's the guy for the future. If not, then you know, a team like Seattle, a team like even like Carolina, someone to set a culture, you need that guy, and Carolina is a perfect spot.
If you want to set a culture, the Chargers need a culture.
That too,
in my opinion. Yeah. But yeah, let's move on to Seattle. And another very shock news.
This is more of a shocker. Because when I heard that Pete Carroll might be fired or let go or he'll part ways, a little surprising. I'm sure if he wanted to be let go.
But there's a little caveat to this one.
Yeah, so he's still an advisor with the Seahawks.
He's still a part of the Seattle Seahawks.
But I didn't listen to the press conference yet, but it sounded like he wanted, from what I saw on Twitter, he sounded like he still wants to coach. 72 years old, though. He's the oldest coach there.
Yeah.
And he does not look like it. Bill looks older.
Exactly.
But Pete Carroll is 72 years old, and he's still doing
so. He's taking that Bruce Arians trend of a couple years ago, where Bruce Arians has took away his head coaching duties and went into a front office role. Same thing here with Pete Carroll. So meaning that Seattle's head coaching job is open, but Pete Carroll has not left the Seattle organization.
You just mentioned Bruce Arians, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's what I thought of instantly as well. I don't know. One thing I'm here to give credit to Pete Carroll, and he said it in his press conference, or he said it in the past, is that the players make the league. The NFL is the players, and he gives credit to the players. Why do you think he's been a head coach for so long? Because he knows that. He adjusted to the times. It's no my way, the highway type of thing, right?
Yeah.
So that's why a guy like Pete Carroll at 72 years old is able to do what he has done. Right.
That's
why Greg Popovich and the NBA is doing what he's doing right now, and so on and so forth. Right. And you have to give Pete credit, because he still made these teams competitive at the end of the day.
Seattle was always
outside of maybe 1 year.
Yeah. Seattle was always competitive.
And he's
Seattle.
A coach that came from college. I think he was a USC coach way back when.
Yeah.
Right. So
you know, Pete Carroll always made this.
He's
Seattle
a legend.
Teams.
He's a Hall of Famer for sure.
Oh, yeah. 100%.
If he wants to coach, he should. And again, I'm not going to say I think he'll stay in Seattle. But if he really wants to coach, then again, the vacancies, he should be up there. Like for a Chargers,
but
I think he should
be
up
that's
there.
That's not going to happen this year.
Yeah.
Because he has taken his advisor role for the Seahawks. There's, I mentioned before, 7 availabilities.
We had to talk about one more news. The Bears.
Yeah.
Is that what you're transitioning to?
Yeah, well, I'm talking about
I have the availabilities in a second, but
yeah, there's 7 availabilities, but the Bears are not one of them.
Okay. My bad, I jumped the gun.
Yeah,
the Bears. Yeah, surprisingly, I'm not as surprised, because they closed out well.
Eberflus is a defensive specialist. Defensively, the Bears picked it up a lot this year.
But
especially helps when you acquire Montez Sweat.
But Bears fired OC Luke Getsy, QB's coach Andrew Janoco, running backs coach Omar Young, wide receivers coach Ty Tolbert, assistant tight ends coach Tim Zetz, according to Adam Schefter.
So basically,
the whole offense is overhauled.
They fired their whole offense.
My question to you is this. Is it for Justin Fields, or is it for Caleb Williams? Or whoever they deemed the number one QB
is? It doesn't matter who it was for. They needed to do this anyways. So obviously, that is the biggest question mark in the Bears offseason. Who will be their quarterback? Is Justin Fields going to be traded? We don't know. Are they going to draft a Caleb Williams or something? But no matter who the quarterback is, they were going to have to make these moves, because at the end of the day, Justin Fields is a young quarterback, and they weren't able to succeed with him. What's going to tell you that they're going to do this? What's going to tell you that they're going to do good with a different young quarterback in Caleb Williams or a Drake May?
Yeah, so we'll see what happens with that. But I do want to say two things before going back to the Bill and the Pete Carroll thing. Pete Carroll gone, right? I'm going to just say this one now. We'll just bring it up now because another old coach is retiring, but from college. The GOAT, Nick Saban.
Nicholas Saban. I don't know if it's Nicholas or not. But Nick Saban, yeah. Obviously.
Came out a huge surprise. No.
Huge surprise, yeah. Alabama, one of the coveted college football programs. They already lost a five-star recruit because of Nick Saban retiring. And Nick Saban made Alabama. As simple as that, right? Like, we've seen these great Alabama teams. We've seen these great players come out of Alabama, right? So it is definitely a huge loss. That is for sure.
Yeah. He was obviously coached LSU to wins. He had the brief stint in Miami Dolphins, didn't do well, came back, changed Alabama around and made them a huge juggernaut. Many draft picks out of Alabama that have been killing it in the NFL, kind of minus the quarterback position, I believe. But outside of that, on the top of my head, I don't fully know. But the running backs and the receivers and the defensive players all have been, the linemen all have been pretty much killing it. So good luck in retirement. He's 70-something years old himself as well. And the reason why I brought Nick Saban up now, because I know we still need to talk about the other coaching situation in a second, is because Pete Carroll, he's done with coaching in the moment. For now,
Bill
Saban's
Belichick.
Retired.
Bill
Do
Belichick.
You believe Bill walks too now, or goes to a different team?
I mean, it's been reported like that.
I'm thinking of end of an era things because here's my bold predictions.
It is end of an era.
I think Bill will probably go to a different team or just retire himself. Right. Bold prediction: Andy Reid retires. Mike Tomlin is no longer a Steeler as well. Get everybody, all the end of the eras, all done in one season. Because I've never seen this before.
I could see. That is bold. That is definitely bold. I could see Tomlin more just because if the Steelers get like shit kicked in the first round.
Yeah.
Right. So
obviously, I'm just saying it. I'm saying it as a joke. But
Reed, obviously, it's gonna be on him. Yeah. And then again, Reed is old himself, so we don't know.
Last thing before we go back to the coaching side of things for NFL, right now the odds-on favorite is Dan Lanning of Oregon's head coach, who was just recently brought there as well a couple of years ago to replace, I think Cristobal was his name. But yeah, he's supposed to be the favorite to be Alabama's next coach. So let's see if that works out, how that goes. But going back to the NFL coaching to close it off with a couple of things, how shocked are you that Dennis Allen is staying?
I'm surprised. I'm definitely surprised. That doesn't mean he is... there's a report saying he's safe?
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, I'm surprised.
Again, it could be wrong because like Bill hasn't been technically gone.
Let go.
So it could still be another week.
It could still happen. It'd
probably be another week.
It could still happen. That is a thing. But at the moment, we thought him and Arthur Smith would be like one of the first guys gone. And he's still safe.
Well, for me, it was him now. And Rivera for sure.
And Rivera as well, Rivera.
Yeah. So like I'm surprised Dennis Allen still has a job.
Yeah,
going
I am surprised
Cleary,
too.
They didn't even make the playoffs.
Yeah.
He could have had an argument if they made the playoffs. Any coaches left in the hot seat that is during the playoffs, it depends on how bad the Buffalo Bills choke. That's the best way I'm going to say it.
It'll
be tough,
it.
But if they go out of the first round, I will not be surprised because this team has failed then for many years in
true.
A row.
That's
the only caveat I'm going to give out of the playoff teams. Is there any other playoff team you could think that could let go of their coach?
Mike McCarthy, because it has to be in the same boat.
Yeah. So
right?
Yeah.
If we're saying the same thing for the Bills, we have to say the same thing for the Cowboys because these are two teams that have favorable matchups, right? The Bills and the Cowboys.
Yeah. So if they both lose in the first round somehow, I could see both of them being let go. But last thing, I'm going to list some coaches. I'm not going to say predict the team. We'll do that more later on when the games get less with the eliminations.
Yeah,
that when
all season starts.
But I'm just saying, I pulled this up because the Panthers have released their head coaching candidates requested so far as of January 8th. But names like Ben Johnson, Lions OC, Texans OC, Bobby Slowick, Bengals OC, Bryce Callahan. Brian Callahan, sorry.
Bryce Callahan's a player.
Cowboys DC, Dan Quinn. Ravens DC, Mike McDonald. Dolphins OC, Frank Smith. Raheem Morris, Rams DC. Todd Monken, which I think will be a little tough.
I think Monken's
tough. That one's a little bit of a stretch.
That's first year.
He hasn't. I don't know if he coached college. Maybe he has. I don't know. But and then Dave Canales, OC.
What do you mean Monken
Bucks.
Coached college? Monken did come from college.
Head coach college. I mean.
Okay. Yeah. That's
because if he's not gonna head coach college, then
that's true.
Right. But other names: Ajero Evero is a name I saw.
Yeah.
Antonio Pierce.
Obviously, yeah.
Ajero Evero right now is rejected because I think the Jags requested to be his DC, But because it's a lateral move, they could reject it because they have an opening as well.
Yeah.
So there's that one, like Ejiro Evero. There was a couple. Aaron Glenn is another name. Lions that popped up. Mike Kafka.
So
I think that the Titans requested Mike Kafka.
There are
a lot of
openings. There are a lot of candidates.
So to your point about Will Levis, Mike Kafka is one of the guys that
I think they requested. Under Brian Daboll is in the Giants OC. So it could be a good piece there just because of the giant success from the previous year. Obviously not so much this year as well.
All right, let's move on. That's it for the NFL for now.
We got coaching in the NFL. Now we got coaching in the NBA.
So this is I'm going to announce this news and I'm going to have a question for you in general. So the Miami Heat have officially extended Eric Spoelstra to 8 years and $120 million extension, making him the second highest paid player behind Greg Popovich. Second highest paid.
Eric Spoelstra has set a Heat culture.
Yeah.
And deserves every single bit of that contract. He is one of the top coaches in the league. And I am not surprised by this move of the Heat wanting to extend Spoelstra.
Okay. No, sorry. Something on the TV popped up that's caught my eye. But my question to you is this. Like, no debates or anything about this. My question to you, when we're talking about the coaches, about Mike Vrabel being fired, setting that culture, why fire him, right? Pete Carroll's a little bit different story. He's also older, so maybe he had a choice. I don't know. The one thing I saw Pee Wee the Plug from formerly Through the Wire, now Numbers on the Board, the new podcast, said that, like, this is why you don't get rid of coaches very easily. LeBron wanted Spoelstra gone. I don't know if you knew that.
I knew that.
Imagine if they
LeBron's a dumbass.
Right? And look at the Heat now. Consistently been the same culture. They know exactly what they need. It helps that you have Pat Riley with him as well. But they have that foundation. They know what they're doing.
I know it is a player's league.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, as a GM, you got to make the decision best for the organization. Because player happy or not, the coach is what get the best out of the players.
Like, you can't, just because the coach had one bad year, and I know I'm saying this as with Darvin Ham, I'm not saying he should be fired, but I am concerned about that because his style of play is also different. There's no culture. If there's a team that has a culture, which Nick Nurse slightly had with you guys, I'm not saying he didn't deserve to be fired, but I wouldn't have mind keeping him and maybe fix the players around. The same thing with Man United, right?
That's true.
The whole Eric Ten Hag thing. I just mentioned Mike Vrabel, right? Like, it's different with Arthur Smith because I don't know. There wasn't really, you didn't see any improvements.
It was 7-10 all 3 years.
Yeah, so there was
Arthur
not any
Smith.
Improvement. So that one, completely understandable. Mike Vrabel got you at a good spot. Eric Spoelstra had you at a good spot. Imagine if Eric Spoelstra was, even after the LeBron thing, let's just say Eric Spoelstra got let go near the end of Wade's tenure. Like, right after the Wade's tenure, because they were, like, a mad team. They weren't going to win it all. Even right now, they're not considered the favorites.
But, no, the difference between the Heat and now, like, they're making the playoffs now with the Wade's tenure ending. They weren't making the playoffs. Yeah.
But at the end of the day, because they could have easily let him go, because we're saying Sean McDermott, right? The same
set
thing.
Set a culture.
He has set a culture. Should Sean McDermott be fired, in my opinion? I don't think he should, but I'm saying from a realistic standpoint.
That's why when you brought it up, I disagreed with you a little bit there.
Like, I'm saying that, though, because we've seen it as a players' league, and it's a results league, not just a players' league. It's also a results league. You got to give Pat Riley credit because you're like, okay, it can't be the coach always, right? Now, the Canucks figured it out on their own. They got rid of Travis Green. After a while, it kind of had to make sense. They had Bruce Boudreau. Got rid of him in a year. They got Talkett. I would have been annoyed if Talkett would have gone fired. If, let's just say, the Canucks did not have this type of season going on, they were in the stage of where Edmonton is right now. Like, this season's Edmonton.
Yeah.
Then I would be like, okay, they're way better. You see differences. Just give it time, right?
Exactly.
So you can't, like, just, like, the coaching culture, creating a culture with the coach, you have to keep it consistent. Because if you keep changing coaches after every 4 years, and we've seen it in many leagues and many teams do this, that's why those teams struggle for the longest time.
Doesn't work. It never works.
Unless you see, like, a full-on fallout, like you had an argument with them, there's a whole different thing. Even then, like, that's a different story. But between players and coaches, you have to find players that fit that coach's mindset. You can't force a coach to fix the player. Right? Like, yeah. I'm upset that Lakers got rid of Frank Vogel.
The coaches bring the best out of the players, right? Yeah. And when you have a coach, when they set a culture of what they want, what they expect from the players, and the players buy in, those are their teams that win it all.
Exactly.
Those are their teams are the best teams in the NBA. And right now, the Sixers are buying in the Nick Nurse thing. Right now, The Thunder are buying in the Mark Dino thing, right?
Dagnall.
I can't pronounce his name. Yeah. But it's been going like that. The Timberwolves are buying into Finch's philosophy, right? These teams have been the best teams. Kings are buying into Mike Brown's offense, right? And his overall coaching ability.
Yeah,
these teams have been the good teams right now.
Same thing with Steve Kerr, but people are going to say, oh, because he had a stacked team, blah, blah, blah. And I'm not saying you fire Steve Kerr either. You got to figure out, I think you got to figure out by getting players for Steve Kerr that could help him and not beat like that one big man shorter, etc. Warriors fans could talk about that below. Yes, I agree there's a time where you have to move on. But I believe like Paul Maurice stepped down as a Winnipeg Jets coach.
Prime example right here. Suns firing Monty Williams.
Yeah.
Why? Look where you are right now. You're still shit compared to where you're supposed to be.
Yeah, because at least with these injuries, Monty has had a thing going,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I disagree with the Monty firing. Yeah, now, in hindsight, you look at Monty with the Pistons.
But it's the Pistons.
Yeah. I disagree. Like, same thing with the Lakers. Like I said, I don't think they should have gotten rid of Frank Vogel just because, they had, two off years. And is it his fault you brought in Russell Westbrook, really?
And no, you couldn't figure because it out? LeBron was the coach.
Yeah, no, even Genie's he was let go because he couldn't figure out the Russell Westbrook thing. But, that's not fair.
I don't think he wanted him.
Right? Like, Frank is now in the Suns. I think Frank will be fine long once they figure it out. Prime example, T. Lou.
Yeah.
I know I don't know why he was fired from Cavs in the first place, but after winning the championships. But, imagine, let's say the Clippers fail this year. I will be mad for them if they fire T. Lou still. Because he's found ways to make the playoffs and he's done amazing job.
Especially
what he did this year so far with the Clippers.
Especially with the Clippers' injuries as well.
Exactly. But speaking of the Clippers, let's transition. Perfect transition point here. They've extended one of their superstar players. Well, I guess he is the only superstar that's worth
Kawhi
the name.
Kawhi Leonard.
Which is funny because it came against the game against the Raptors.
It's pain. Every time I see Kawhi Leonard extended, I'm like, why?
It's not going to happen. You have no chance.
Yeah, we have no chance.
Kawhi Leonard and the Clippers agreed to a 3-year, $152 million contract extension. I believe there's no opt-outs at this point. And the 32-year-old star will make $52 million next season and $50 million approximately in each of the next two campaigns, according to Adrian Wojnarowski and then also Shams with the initial reporting of 3 years, $152.4 million. They're not going to be done there yet. They're still trying to extend Paul George. So those Indiana Pacers fans that want him back home may not happen. So beware of that.
The Clippers are still buying in with their with this
Paul
foundation.
Paul George
that
does
they,
have a play yeah. option next year.
The Clippers are buying into this foundation they built in, obviously, by signing Kawhi Leonard and trading for Paul George. They built around this roster very well. They've been pretty healthy this year, performing well. Just got a win over the Raptors right now, and their star players are playing together.
James Harden,
T. Lou is buying him in.
The question mark is, how much money will James Harden want next year? Assuming they extend Paul George, then James Harden's also he can't extend. He's not eligible to extend, so he has to wait till UFAs. But the one thing that annoys me though is with all these stars extending. I know LeBron, I think, is also a free agent next year, but LeBron did extend technically early on with his Lakers tenure after the championship. A lot of these stars are now becoming free agents, like that free agent class of 2019 was.
Yeah, that 2019 class was.
Because right now Jimmy Butler, I believe, is extended. KD has extended with the Nets before he got traded. Obviously Bradley Beal, Devin Booker.
But there were a lot of.
They're taking the NHL approach of extending players now.
Yeah.
Rather than hitting the open market.
No, there were so many good players there. It was like we can't even list them for you guys. Like, that's how many good players there were.
Yeah, there was at least 10 you could think
of.
But yeah, that's the unfortunate thing about this because the offseason drama, but the trades are still good enough to be made. But moving on, we got a little bit of a story we need to talk about. We got to talk about officiating as a whole, but we'll talk about the NBA and the NHL stories recently. And NBA, starting off with the ending of the Pacers versus Celtics game, the game where Haliburton did get hurt. But what ended up happening was Jaylen Brown got a foul call. He got fouled. I think Buddy Hield hit him on the head or something. They reviewed it and overturned it, saying it's not a foul. And apparently afterwards, Mazzulla said Hield did say I did foul him. So it's kind of strange. So there's a drama there. And Mr. Raptor fan, even though you didn't miss the ending of this game, but you did go back and watch a little bit of this, the ending of the Lakers-Raptors game was a shit show to the point where Darko Rajakovic, head coach of the Raptors, went off in one of the best rants because it was like polite.
It was the most respectful.
Most
respectful rant you could think of. So for that reason, he should not be fined. But yeah, officiating. Biggest issue is inconsistencies, right? Because we've seen it was a missed call on Jaylen Brown. He clearly got hit in the head.
They called it, but overturned.
You cannot mess that one up, yeah. Right? Like when the screen is right in front of you and you overturn it, like why? What's the point of that? Like I don't get that.
Yeah.
Raptors Lakers, obviously it was a little bit inflated, so I'm not gonna say the actual number, but the actual number was like 23-2 in free throws. But we'll say the actual number is around like
I think 10 of those free throws were
like 13
intentional fouls.
13 to like 15 free throws.
Yeah.
To two. Still a wide margin of still a big gap between the two teams in a singular quarter. The issue is this. When I watched that game, Emmanuel quickly got a flagrant for obviously the Euro step elbowing. Cam Reddish. Fair, you called that, whatever. We've seen that call before. Siakam got his legs taken out in the first quarter by Torian Prince. That wasn't a flagrant. Point number two, Scotty should have had an and one dunk in the end of the fourth quarter, which could have potentially, you know, made it into a one possession game without extra fouling, right? Like that point was crucial. They needed that whistle. He drove, dunked the ball, got hit four different times driving to the hoop. LeBron got the same call when he just did a normal play like LeBron does, goes into Scotty, hits his layup. He gets an and one call, and that was a soft call right there.
So
another one more. There's one more. Barnes over 80. Good finish by Barnes. Good defense by 80, right? There was a little bit of contact. I want to call it, personally. Issue is, Austin Reeves, he's not even LeBron James or Anthony Davis. He gets the same call. Legit, the whistle is blown 20 seconds after he misses the shot.
You forgot the big one. The offensive.
You'd bring that one up.
I saw King of the Fourth Quarter, Kenny Beecham, talk about it. He did say it seems like a foul, but the problem is you don't see them called often at that moment of the game. That's the problem. It is a moving screen. You have to admit that.
Yeah,
part.
I'm not
saying you. I'm not saying like that in general.
Okay, the issue in this game was the calls were fouls, but the Raptors got hit the same amount of time as the Lakers did and did not get the calls.
So the point is, like, even to your point with the free throw disparity, because we've seen Warrior fans or those type of the fans in general complain about this before, not just for the Lakers, but in general. Because as a Lakers fan, I do admit it was like pretty bad reffing. Now, it could be Ben Taylor taking his anger out of Fred VanVleet from last year making those comments, but against the Raptors, so it's the same thing. My point is, like, as a Laker fan, we've seen the same, like, the Scotty missed and won. LeBron, as a fan of watching the Lakers, has been not getting those calls all year. So it's kind of weird sitting on this side. And every fan is going to be pissed about their team getting missed calls all the time. Like, it's normal. We've seen, like, Bravades from the Suns, as a Suns fan, say all that. The problem is, with the free throw disparity, it also depends on the type of free throws they're given, right? Like, what I mean is, are you a jump shooting team? If you are, then you ain't gonna get the call, right? Because, like, how often do you foul a jump shooter, right? Which was the case in that Warrior series, in my opinion. This case, I agree with you. Scotty got fouled a few times when he went for dunks. We've seen other ones that the Lakers got called and the Raptors did not go called. I agree with you. I'm not disagreeing with anything you said there. The issue is the inconsistencies in every sport possible. Then the issue after that is when you do a review and you can't come to a conclusion, and then you still get it wrong.
You
50-50 it.
You
right?
You have the screen in front of you, and you still get it wrong.
The inconsistency for me is always a late whistle. That's the one that pisses me off, even if I'm the fan of the team, because they're waiting to see if the ball went in.
That is true.
100%. A lot of the time, in my opinion. Yeah. This isn't some VAR offside rule where let the play go on and score, even if it was a clear offside. This is like, you took a shot, he was fouled. Okay, you waited till it hit the rim once. Okay, then I'll just call it, and then maybe the ball goes in and one. If not, okay.
Yeah, legit, that Reeves call, Raptors got the ball and were about to fast break, and you blew the whistle.
There was one, like, I'm not disagreeing with any Raptor fan that they're mad about this. I agree with Darko in a sense. Like, again, you watching Raptors game more now because, A, they're actually fun to watch. But, B, you have the time. And then, C, You've always complained about Raptors reffing in the past in general before we even ever started the podcast, right? To the point where a quick little story, Jovan would throw pillows during the playoff
championship there. Run, yeah.
But no, it's just even any sport, and we'll get to the NHL now. And Connor McDavid said it perfectly, because when it comes to the reviews, especially, they're reviewing an offside play yesterday about the. I think it was Draisaitl was offside or something. It
took 20 minutes.
And it took 20 minutes. It took the same amount of time as a period would. Like an in-game period game would, right? It makes no sense. Like if you don't know, it can't take, if it takes you that long, then you're definitely guessing at that point.
Yeah, and that's the point.
And offsides are straightforward
usually. The longer it takes,
the more you're going to guess.
The more you're going to guess, one. But number two, the more it just shows that there's always this rule involved in every sports, if there's not conclusive evidence to overturn a call, you shouldn't overturn a call. The longer it takes, you don't have the conclusive evidence.
NHL and NBA is different in a way. NBA, the refs make the decision. NHL, Connor did say when he talked to the linesman, and for it was out of their hands when a coach challenged it goes to Toronto, right? So, excuse me.
That goes to Toronto, eh?
that's where the headquarters are, right? So that's where there's a slight difference there. Same thing with the NFL and all that. So. We're not going to ramble on it too much. We know officiating is hard, but everybody asks for for same amount.
Just call it for both teams the same way.
It's not just right. Both, everybody across the league. It can't be like one game you call that and the next game you don't. I know you're different officials, but you're all under one league. This isn't like you're reffing a FIBA game one day and you're going into the
NBA. Like, it doesn't matter. Like, okay, there's like, there's MLB, for example. Some people have a wider strike zone. Umpires have done other ones. The issue is the player should not be adjusting game after game for how the referee is going to ref.
Yeah.
Right?
100%.
The player should be playing the game to adjust to the other team.
If the players are following the rules to how they have to follow it, the referee should be doing the same thing.
Exactly.
Right? So we'll hold it there. Let's get to the NHL very quickly. The All-Star vote should be the remaining All-Star should be announced. Let's just say by the time this comes out. Let me pull up what the leading voters are, because NHL, this is purely on votes to get the remaining All-Stars. And like we said before, you could check out the last episode. We think it's very stupid that every team gets a representative. But let me just pull it up.
But just, it is how it is. But there's some good news for Canucks fans. Yeah, that is for sure.
So voting-wise, also if you're mad that if your players are not getting voted, blame your fan base.
Blame yourself. You're not voting yourself, probably.
Yeah. So the top eight vote leaders for goalies are... So the four only get in for goalies.
Yeah.
It's Thatcher Demko leading it, and he's leading it by almost kind of not doubled, but like it's 440 to 780.
Hey, man. The boy Demko's in.
Sergei Bobrovsky is second. Jeremy Swayman's third, and Alexander Gorgiev is fourth. So four are looks. It's close between him and Ullmark.
If
so
you're looking at
Boston, could get two goalies in, by the way.
Potentially, yeah.
Yeah, they have the best tandem. Then it's probably the Canucks. But right now, those are the four goalies.
Bro, my boy Casey DeSmith got robbed.
Aiden Hill is robbed.
Yeah, that is true. Aiden Hill has been performing well.
Right,
Marc-Andre
Fleury's on this. This could be partially purely biased as well, but Aiden Hill is robbed because some people think he is a Vezina favorite this year.
Yeah, he's been performing really well.
On the other side.
The players, the skaters, the top eight skaters. So Nylander is leading the way here.
Yeah, but I don't know why the score or they deleted the tweet.
You got rid of it?
No, like it's on the score. They got rid of the tweet, I think.
Well,
I got to search it up. But I know Nylander. Okay, let's just talk about the Canucks.
Yeah, all right, Nylander's in there, obviously. But then you have Makar is also in there. The Canucks players are in there. JT Miller, Brock Besser, Elias Pettersson. Meaning, at the moment, if the vote stands how it is, Canucks have five All-Stars, including Quinn Hughes being the early representative.
So right now, it is, I think, eight people get in, right?
Yeah, top eight.
So William Nylander, Cale Makar, Leon Draisaitl, Elias Pettersson, Mitch Marner, JT Miller, Brock Besser, and Artemi Panarin all will get in. So this is where I have the issue now. First of all, some of these guys should be locks from the beginning. Yeah. Right? You're telling me a guy like Mikko Rantanen is going to be missing.
Yes.
A guy like Evan Bouchard.
He's been performing well.
Not Evan Bouchard, sorry.
Even though Bouchard has been performing well.
Yeah, he's been performing. I was thinking of the other, Noah Dobson.
Noah Dobson, yeah.
Noah Dobson is probably missing. You're telling me that Artemi Panarin is almost missing.
Yeah, Artemi Panarin should not be missing this
he
at all.
He should not be missing. Mika Zibanejad here in a way for how good that team is. So, like, Mikko Rantanen will probably miss.
That is crazy.
Like, we know that from the votings, a lock. We knew the locks are Nylander. Not Nylander. Kale McCarr and Draisaitl were going to be locks no matter what.
Nylander as well.
Nylander as well. But I'm just saying, usually, year by year case, Draisaitl and McCarr are always going to be locks as a secondary piece.
Yeah, for sure.
Or McKinnon and McCarr if they swap, right? That's crazy. Like, it's automatically voted that McDavid will be an all-star and there's a chance Draisaitl will miss. There's a chance.
There's always a chance, yeah.
That Draisaitl will miss out. But, like I said, Connor Bedard's injury is one of them. I think Jack Hughes is also injured. So, because of that, some of these guys will get voted in. Now, I don't know if it has to be from their team. So, I don't know if Jason Dickinson gets in. Or, in this case, a guy like Zach Hyman will get in.
Yeah. But, catch our last pod where we explain our thoughts of why we hate the All-Star format.
It's dumb.
We're not going to get into it again.
Yeah.
But, this one, we're just sharing your guys' the fan votes. And, Canucks fans, you should be very happy right now.
We're a strong fan base.
Good job voting. Well, okay. Let's move on to our...
The rest of it is going to be a little quick.
Yeah, very next
quickly,
topic.
But some news came out right now from the UFC. UFC 300 has its first title fight. And it's Zhang Wei Li will defend her strawweight title versus Yan Xiaonan. I butchered the hell out of the name. I apologize to you. But yeah, so that's the rematch. Oh, sorry, not the rematch. That's the first title fight of UFC 300.
Yeah, we better get more. That's all I care about. But yeah, that'll be a good way. Obviously, Zhang Weili is
probably
entertaining, entertaining as hell.
Yeah.
But yeah, is that only UFC news right there?
That's the only one.
MLB news: Cubs agreed to a 4-year, $53 million deal with Shota Imanaga, player from Japan League. Another Japanese player is signing. This is the third one now. Or second one. Well, third one if you're counting Otani.
Yeah.
But like second player from coming from the Japan
known
league.
Name.
I yeah. They got themselves a pitcher. This, in my opinion, is making it more likely that Marcus Stroman will not return to the Cubs. So making him a free agent available to other teams. The Cubs already have Justin Steele, so they're adding to their rotation with Imanaga. Obviously, WBC comes to mind, how they performed in the WBC. Japan won it all. So, obviously, Yamamoto was a big name there. This is another one. And, obviously, Otani as well. So, it's a big deal. There's definitely a lot of Japan fans going to be tuning into the MLB now. For sure.
Nothing else?
Nothing else.
Okay, soccer side of things, just a couple of news. Jadon Sancho is officially on loan back to Dortmund. But it's no buy option. So there's that. First leg of the first semifinal of the Carabao Cup, Liverpool ended up winning 2-1 over Fulham. The second one is between Chelsea and... Oh, no, that one already happened.
I think that one already happened, yeah.
Okay, so I think the finals should be set then.
No.
Oh, no, it's two legs, right?
Yeah, it's two legs.
So Liverpool is up 2-1.
Liverpool's up 2-1.
And Chelsea is down 1-0 to Middlesbrough.
Jeez.
So that's crazy. So that's that news. The other news coming out, and this is related to Canada soccer. We actually talked about this with Peter Galindo back when we had him on last, of his prediction about Alphonso Davies. It is that Real Madrid mull summer bid over Byron Davies, assuming he does not sign an extension.
So Madrid has interest in Davies.
They're monitoring it.
Davies has interest in Madrid just because he said himself that, like, who would not want to play for Madrid?
Yeah.
Right? Obviously, Real Madrid, one of the biggest clubs in the world. And for Davies, obviously, this will be a hell of a lot more exposure, especially going to Real Madrid.
Yeah. So, there's nothing much else that is out. I'll quickly just double check if Fabrizio, because technically it is morning in Europe, but I doubt Fabrizio Romano goes to sleep. Anyways.
Probably doesn't, right? Just always on the phone, always messaging, always calling.
I think I remember seeing
always
his,
reporting.
Like, well, hey, I should. Oh, he has an email. I should email him.
Does it come on the pod?
Fabrizio Romano on the pod, please. I think the only ones, like the big ones, is that one.
Yeah, January is much more dead compared to, obviously, September and August. Obvious reason is because it's hard to, like, switch teams in the middle of the year. But whereas August and September, you start from the beginning. You
usually see it more near the end of the month as well, though.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, Leonardo Bernucci is in Istanbul, new Fenerbahce signing.
Oh, wow.
I don't even know where he went after Juventus. It was somewhere else. But
yeah.
Yeah, so outside of that, that's pretty much it from us. Obviously, a lot of NFL talk, a lot of good conversations with the NBA.
Stay tuned for the next 2 days. You'll be getting two uploads. Obviously, one is a guest video. One is another.
As we talk about the reffing thing, that's what popped up on the screen.
One is a guest video on Saturday. Another one on Friday is a special NFL video for sleeper teams that could win. And
So other than that, make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe. Make sure you guys download the podcast on audio platforms and rate and review it. Follow all our socials linked down below. And other than that, we'll catch you guys on the next one.
Peace.